It's time to get to work. Over the next 3 months, I'm going to do everything I can to keep America great again. So that when we come back here in November, get ready, we got to come back here in November. I have earned your vote for a second time.
Can you believe how close this is? We are in a tie ball game. We went door to door. We went house to house. We made our case for change. We're going to make that case tomorrow. We're not stopping now. Tomorrow we rest, and then we keep fighting through to November. Let's go out there. Let's get it done. Let's change this country.
The closely watched special election in Ohio is this morning too close to call. That's according to NBC News. You heard at the top Republican Troy Balderson and Democrat Danny O'Connor speaking last night, with Balderson currently leading O'Connor by less than 1% of all votes cast. That's 1,754 votes ahead in a district that has been in GOP hands for three decades. The official outcome may not be known until over 3,400 provisional ballots are tallied in the coming weeks. And the race could be headed to a recount if the candidates end up within half a percent of each other after the final results are certified this morning. Troy Balderson is claiming victory, but Danny O'Connor has not conceded. And regardless of the outcome, we're going to see a rematch between these two come November when they compete for full term in Congress. Welcome to Morning Joe. It is Wednesday, August 8th. With Joe, Willie, and me, we have Associate Editor of Commentary Magazine, Noah Rothman, former Treasury official and Morning Joe economic analyst, Steve Rattner, and national political correspondent for NBC News and MSNBC. Is he still awake? Is he still awake? Steve Kornacki. Joe, the guy's been up all night. I don't know.
He's been up all night.
Look
also,
at him.
These two poor candidates have been up not only all night, but been up probably the last 3 weeks. And think about what they're doing. They are fighting tooth and nail. They're giving everything that they have, all for the glory of winning a special election that will seat them in Congress for about a month and a half. And then they have to do it again. And of course, run for a full term in November. But Mika, this race, we don't know who's going to end up winning it. Regardless of who ends up winning it, Republicans certainly know, as well as Democrats, that, I mean, this is another race where Republicans have underperformed. They underperformed in a district that is deep, deep red. I mean, I'll talk to Steve in a second. I think maybe Democrats have won it once since the 1930s. But you see the same thing happening. They're bleeding. Republicans are bleeding so badly right now in suburbs. And then you go north of Franklin County to the exurbs. They're basically splitting it, holding their own, but again, losing a ton of votes. This is a party, the Republican Party, that's becoming more and more every day a rural party. Also, the thing I've always loved, and I've talked about it for years on this show, I love what Madison and Hamilton and our founders did when they put down a government that constantly has this system of checks and balances, elections every 2 years, that always have the electorate sort of tugging and pulling. You see a lot of voters out there thinking, a lot of Republicans, a lot of moderates, a lot of independents thinking that Donald Trump has gone too far. So they're pulling back the other way. Yesterday, something remarkable happened in Missouri, a very conservative state, a very pro-Trump state, a very pro-Republican state. You actually had people coming out in a referendum and dealing a blow to the right to work forces who were really buoyed by a Supreme Court decision that actually was seen as a death knell for unions. Well, yesterday, I've got to say, that union win in Missouri, one of the biggest wins they've had in a very long time. And again, you just have to believe, once again, that's the electorate sort of tugging and pulling back. Oh, okay, the Supreme Court's going to take us too far to the right. We're going to pull this country back to the center. Pretty remarkable what we see in, you know, every time Americans go to the voting booth.
Well, it's been amazing to watch overnight, and the people are having a chance to speak. But Willie Geist, the president certainly is taking this one in Ohio personally.
Well, he's declared victory. He sent out a tweet last night. Of course, we don't have an official call yet here at NBC News, but he's declared victory. He said, when I decided to go to Ohio for Troy Balderson, he was down in early voting 64-36. That was not good. After my speech on Saturday night, there was a big turn for the better. Now Troy wins a great victory during a very tough time of the year for voting. He will win big in November. So, Steve Kornacki, let's talk about what happened last night. As Mika referenced, this has been a Republican seat since 1982, consecutively, since John Kasich won it. President Trump, less than 2 years ago, won it by 11 points. First of all, the numbers here, is there a chance, with Balderson up by about 1,700 votes right now, with provisional ballots, with mail-in ballots, that that result changes, that O'Connor somehow comes out on top?
The suspense here is extra weird on this one, because you expect those provisional ballots there to break toward the Democrat. You don't expect them to actually erase 1,754 vote Republican lead. However, if the margin there were to cut that 1,754 in half, which is not implausible, then that the overall victory margin for Balderson would be under 0.5 points. And by state law, if you're under 0.5, and that's more generous than you're going to see in some other places, but if you're under 0.5, there is automatically a recount. So we're in a situation right now where I think it's plausible that O'Connor, with the provisional votes, can get it close enough that the state law is triggered, causing a recount. And even then, if you're a Democrat, I wouldn't get your hopes up necessarily, because these recounts don't tend to change huge numbers of votes. And you know, O'Connor would be in a position where he probably needs to change 700-800 votes. But hey, nothing's impossible in politics. So you'd much rather be in Balderson's position, much rather be in Balderson's position than O'Connor. But it's not implausible. We are going to go through a recount that could take this thing out into late August.
Well, then we're talking late August, early September recount with, as Joe said, then another election between these same two guys 2 months later. However that comes out, if there is a recount, what did we learn about the state of the Republican Party last night?
Yeah, I mean, so there were three parts of this district, but focus first on that question of the suburbs right in and immediately around Columbus, northern Franklin County. It was more than a third of the district. Put this in some perspective. The Franklin County part of this district has gone, in the span of 6 years, and you can attribute this entirely to Donald Trump, from Obama winning it by 3 points in 2012, to Clinton winning it by 18 in 2016, to the Democrat Danny O'Connor winning it by 31 points last night, from 3 to 31.
Wow.
In the span of basically half a decade. That's the Trump effect in places like Franklin County, Ohio. And last night, the margin was there for Democrats. The turnout seemed to be, if you had told Democrats at the start of the night, this is what Franklin's going to look like, they would have said, that's it, we won, let's start the celebration. Those were more than the numbers they thought they needed. What didn't happen for them last night? The turnout was not great in the rural parts of the district, but Balderson attracted Trump-level support among the people who did vote in the rural part of the district. There was some talk that that might recede back towards the Democrats a little. Didn't happen. Balderson was up around 70% in some of these rural counties, so that didn't happen. And then the bottom line, it all came down to Delaware County, which is wealthy, which is suburban. It's a little different, I think, in character than Franklin County. When we say suburbs, Franklin County is a little bit more, it's closer to, it's a little bit more, in some cases, blended with the city. When you take a step, that next level of suburb out, that's kind of Delaware. And what happened there was, by historical standards, Trump didn't do well for, Balderson didn't do well for a Republican, but he matched the Trump number. He didn't fall back further from the Trump number. So it was just, it looks like just enough there to hang on in what was a Trump by 11 district 2 years ago.
Yeah, I want to ask really quickly, Steve, about Delaware County, and we're certainly not dissing Donald Trump, and we'd all say it here. I think that Donald Trump, in most Republican primaries, is going to be the deciding factor. What's interesting last night, and a bit ironic, a guy that he can't stand, John Kasich, if you look at Delaware County and look at Kasich's home county and see that actually in Franklin County, Trump's candidate's getting wiped out. But in Delaware County, a last-minute endorsement by John Kasich had to have a significant impact for the Republican candidate and help him hang on there, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny. You think of some of the events in the final days of this campaign that got so much attention, and you can overinterpret everything, but you can see them having very different effects on very different groups of voters in the district. Kasich coming out and endorsing the Republican, sort of giving that, you know, more moderate Republican stamp of approval. Absolutely. You know, you look at Delaware County, Kasich coming out for that matter and saying publicly, hey, I don't know if Balderson even wanted Trump coming. I don't know how this guy ended up out here. Again, you could see that tailor-made for Delaware County. The fact, though, that Donald Trump was out there, the fact that the day before the election you had Balderson dissing Franklin, my God, you look at the turnout in Franklin, you see maybe it backfired, you know, right there.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, he didn't. Last night, he came out, Balderson came out, thanked a lot of people. He didn't thank John Kasich, which was not a class move. And maybe he's trying to please Donald Trump by not thanking John Kasich. That's somebody that would help him out in November. So we'll see. Politics is always very fascinating. But Noah Rothman, you had tweeted at the end of the night that for conservatives, for Republicans, not a lot to be cheerful about. A very bad night for Republicans underperforming. And you said for conservatives and for the conservative movement, the worst bit of news actually came out of Missouri.
Yeah, you mentioned it. It was the right to work vote. Missouri, as you said, is pretty red state at this point, Senator Claire McCaskill notwithstanding. And half the union at this point is right to work, which is essentially means you don't have to join a union if you join a union shop. You don't have to be forced into a union. And if you don't join a union, you don't have to be forced to pay union dues. That was the Supreme Court decision you mentioned. And we're beginning to see a big rollback here. On the state level, Democrats are expected to do very well, and particularly in governorships. And we spend a lot of time focusing on Congress, but governorships are arguably far more important when it comes to reforms like this, advancing conservative reforms. And they've done extraordinarily well in advancing them over the course of the Obama years. If we're seeing this rollback right now, it is extraordinarily disheartening from a conservative perspective. And if you look at more of the national environment, I mean, we got a taste of it in Ohio, but we saw some of it, too, in Washington, where they have a top two primary system. It's functionally a Democrat versus Republican race, and candidates like incumbent Representative Kathy McMorris Rodgers got just barely ahead of her Democratic opponent, 0.4 of a point at this point. And she's the fourth-ranking Republican in Congress. There's very little you can look at the results last night and say Republicans had a very good night. They squeaked out something of a victory in Ohio. You could call it a victory, but it's a very Pyrrhic one.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube. And make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.